Good morning. Good morning and welcome to St. John's. We are so glad to see each one of you here today. It's good to be out of the cold and here in the house of the Lord for worship. We are in for a treat this morning with our Joy Choir and our Alleluia Choir. Our children will be here with our opening anthem. So let us prepare our hearts for worship.
Thank you.
you to our children, our directors and parents. Wonderful to hear these young voices. Let us join together in prayer, the opening prayer found in your bulletin. Let us pray. Jesus, Savior and Lord, enlighten our minds with your wisdom and imprint the image of your love once more on our hearts so that we can focus anew on your presence and your power whenever and wherever you call us to serve people in your name. Amen. Welcome again this morning to St. John's. Do take time to fill out the friendship pads. They're the booklets located near the center aisle, and pass them down to those around you and take a look at who's on the pew with you and greet them after the service. I remind you that Trunk or Treat is this afternoon, so hopefully we'll see all these boys and girls tonight and parents and families there with trunks all decorated. That begins at 5 o'clock. Be there at 4:45 if you're trunk or treating, and if you're a trunk, be there at 4 to 4:15. This is the week we have been waiting for here at St. John's. Apple Fest is this coming Saturday, so if you have not been involved yet, you can bring your household goods, you can bring your baked goods, you can bring your gently used clothes, and the Appleseed Cafe is in need of canned drinks and bottled water. And there are lots of other ways to be involved. The three groups that will be benefited by Apple Fest this year are Community Care and Counseling, Christ Central, and also St. John's Seed Program. I remind you that next Sunday is our All Saints service here at all three services, and the banner in the narthex is there for everyone to add a bell in memory of loved ones that you would like to remember. And Operation Christmas Child is almost ready to compile those boxes, so bring your items this week to the church and come back on Sunday afternoon to help assemble the boxes. Do take time to look at your bulletins. There's lots of information, lots of things going on. But I especially like you to mark your calendar for November the 11th. This is the Harvest Home Concert, which is a benefit for one of our mission partners, ACTS, here in town. And now I invite Zenith Sharp, who is coming to share a stewardship reflection with us.
I was privileged to hear these children this morning at the 9:02 service, and I told them then that they were a hard act to follow. And you're privileged to have heard them this morning. Good morning, St. John's Church family. To those of you who may not know me, I am Barbara Zenith Sharp, and I introduce myself that way because most of you probably know me as Zenith, but Barbara really is my first name, and there's a story how both those names got involved, but we won't do that this morning. This year's stewardship theme, as you already know, is Step Up. That's exactly what I have literally done this morning. I have stepped up this morning to speak to you a few minutes about our church. St. John's has been my church for 50 plus years, and during those years, I have been and continue to be in its loving care. This care is very real to me, both spiritually and emotionally, during both happy times and the sad ones. Yes, I love St. John's Church and my caring, kind, and compassionate church family. When I was asked to speak to you this morning, I reluctantly said, maybe. Let me think a little bit about this and pray a lot. And after much consideration and lots of prayers to God for guidance, I said, I'll do my best. God has provided me the method I am using this morning to speak to you for a few minutes about our 2019 stewardship theme, Step Up. In my simplistic way, please allow me to give my interpretation for each letter of the word step up. S for me stands for strength. We need strength to do whatever we do, be it get up in the morning or get in the car to go to work or go in our houses or come into God's house. Believe me when I say it took real strength for me to step up here to speak with you this morning. Where do we get our strength? In the Living Bible translation, Psalm 121, verses 1 through 4, we read, "Shall I look to the mountain gods for help? No, my help is from Jehovah, who made the mountains and the heavens too. He will never let me stumble, slip, or fall. For he's always watching, never sleeping. So step up. Use your strength vigorously to strengthen our church in all the ways that you can by your attendance, your prayer, your praise, and your financial support." T for me stands for talents. Yes, we all have talents that we are not using. In Matthew chapter 25, we read the parable of the talents and how they were used. Very few, if any, are good at everything, but all of us have talents. So search through your God-given talents and share. Give of your time, your resources, your voice. These children, they use their voices this morning. Join the choir. I'm sure they can always use some more. Your mechanical skills, your ability to lead a Bible study, your organizational skills, your cooking skills. I'm sure Jeannie would welcome you in the kitchen. Or perhaps just a smile. Step up. Use your God-given talents. E. The letter E for me represents effect. As we use our strength and our talents in a positive manner, there will be effects such as accomplishments, fulfillment, production, or bringing about a change. Isn't that what St. John's is all about? In 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 3, we read, "But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace to me was not without effect." Let's step up together, causing positive effects for our church by giving generously and using our talents. We are all different in our own way, but if we step up together, just imagine what effects we can cause. P represents purpose. My life is barren without a purpose. Things I intend to do, a design, a plan, my intentions. Ephesians 1:11 says, "In him we were chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will." God had a purpose. We must also have a purpose. I'm sure many of you have read Rick Warren's book, The Purpose-Driven Life, in which he poses the question, what on earth am I here for? That's a good question for us today. Proverbs 19:20 says, "Many are the plans in a man's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails." So step up, re-examine your purposes. And up, and the letter U. U is understanding. No, we do not always understand the who, the when, the why, the where, or certainly the why. Trust God. He knows. In 1 Kings chapter 4, verse 20, we are told, God gave Solomon wisdom, and very great insight, and a breadth of understanding as measureless as the sand on the seashore. God is extravagant with his gifts to us. We are each blessed beyond measure by his gifts. Step up, share your gifts, your resources, and your blessings. And finally, P. P is, to me, is pleasure. Pleasure is a feeling produced by enjoyment and expectation of something good. I don't know about you, but some of the things that give me pleasure are sharing my resources, doing something for others, listening to someone who needs to talk, sharing a ride, saying hello to the people I meet along the way, attending and supporting St. John's Church, fellowship, certainly the food that we enjoy around here, my personal family, knowing that God loves me, and that feeling that I belong here. So take a sip of happiness by serving our church in a way that is pleasing to God. Step up, my friends. Serve St. John's with S, your strength. Be strong. T, your talents. Share what God has given you. E, your effects. Work to cause good effects. P, your purpose. Be courageous. U, your understanding. Search for the truth. P, your pleasures. God will provide. You cannot outgive God. Thank you.
Respond as we stand and affirm our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us join together in prayer. Gracious God, we are grateful for the sounds of music this morning and how it lifts our spirits, how it gives us hope, and how it, we pray, O Lord, brings you praise. For the more that we praise you and the more that we see how great you are, it helps us know that all of our difficulties are insignificant in comparison to who you are and how great you are. So, Lord, we pray for your strength to be with people all over this community and our church and even our country and world. We pray especially today for those in Pittsburgh and the families of those who have lost loved ones, from law enforcement to the persons worshiping in the synagogue located there. Oh, Lord, we pray that you sustain them and give them grace. We pray that you will be with those who have been terrorized by those bombs mailed to different individuals. Lord, we pray for ourselves that we, in the midst of our being pummeled by life and terrorized and stricken by uncertainty, that you might give us hope that lasts, that you might forgive us of our sins as we confess them. As we seek, O Lord, to be at peace with one another, help us not just to rest in peace, but help us to live in peace. Lord, we pray that we would proclaim who you are as Lord and Savior in every way that we live, that we would live the golden rule to do unto others as we would have them to do unto us. Help us, Lord, to represent your kindness and your love. But Lord, remind us that that love is not a love that is cheap grace or without standards, but it is a love that is tempered by a concern for others that would want them to live better and to be better. And we pray that prayer for ourselves, that we might be better Christians, that we might be better followers and better friends, better neighbors. Oh, Lord, we pray that you be with the children this week as Halloween and All Hallows Eve approaches, that you might protect them in every way. Bless all the teachers and all the educators among us. Bless all the families represented here today. Protect the children, protect us all as we are your children. Hear our prayers. We pray them in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who taught his disciples and has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Before I invite the ushers forward, I want you to make special notice of the solo that Joshua Barfoot is going to be singing along with the chancel choir. The words for their song it's found in your bulletin. And now I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward as we give to God as God has given to us.
Oh,
Remain standing as we sing our hymn of preparation, number 170, Oh, How I Love Jesus. And we invite our children to follow the crucifer to Children's Church.
Standing for the gospel lesson. Mark chapter 10, beginning at verse 46. And then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus stopped and said, "Call him." And so they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. And Jesus asked him, "What do you want me to do for you?" And the blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately, he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. You may be seated. Well, midterm elections are almost upon us, but there's an election that's more important than the ones between Democrats and Republicans and independents. But first, let me tell a story. Two friends who had different political views, they both had their own favorite candidates that they wanted to support. One of them said to the other on election day, "You know, we've been arguing about who's the right person to vote for months now, and we're going to cancel out each other's votes. We've never come to a conclusion about who's right and who's wrong, and so since we're going to cancel out one another's votes, why don't we just shake hands on it and then go to our respective homes and not even go to the trouble?" And so that's exactly what they did. An observer standing nearby said, "That was a real sportsmanlike offer you just made to that fellow." And the guy who had made the deal about going home said, "Not really. That's the third time I've done that today." Well, Jesus was at his midterm election. He had already announced to the crowds and to his disciples three times that he was going to go to Jerusalem and die. Three times. But here he is, before making his way to Jerusalem. He is leaving the city of Jericho. He's going to travel that 15 miles, that steep climb from Jericho up to Jerusalem. He is in the middle of his midterm election. The choices by the people in his large crowd following him, whether or not they will stick with him or whether or not when they get to Jerusalem, they will end up by that next Friday after Palm Sunday shouting, "Crucify him, crucify him." There is a sense in which, indeed, Jesus is at his midterm, and he gets, from of all places, a vote from one that everybody else looked down upon, Bartimaeus. We don't even know what Bartimaeus' name really is. We just call him Bartimaeus because Bartimaeus, literally, as it says in the text, it means son of Timaeus. We don't even know what his friends called him. But we do know that times were tough, not only for him, but for the whole countryside, oppressed by Roman taxes and soldiers, oppressed by all sorts of changes that were taking place, not unlike what we've been going through, especially not unlike what Pittsburgh has been going through or much of our country, as anxiety is at a high level as we approach these midterms. It reminds me, our day and time reminds me of the songwriter Don McLean's special song. I call it his special song. He had some other great hits, but I especially like his Bye Bye, Miss American Pie. Goodbye to the good old days. Goodbye because the music has died. Of course, he was talking about Buddy Holly and J.P. Big Bopper Richardson and Richie Valens and how they died in a plane crash on that day the music died. But then he goes through this long, eight, almost 9 minute song that tells about the whole history of the 60s and how we had a war and how we had civil rights and we had demonstrations and we had all sorts of difficulty for all sorts of people. We had assassinations like Martin Luther King Jr. and Bobby Kennedy and John F. Kennedy. It was a tough time to be alive. And for Don McLean, it was a time when the music died. Bye bye, Miss American Pie. I drove my Chevy to the levee, but the levee was dry. Then them good old boys were drinking whiskey and rye and saying, "This will be the day that I die." And then it reaches its anti-climax. It reaches its depth of despair when at the end of the song, Don McLean sings, after singing the chorus, "Bye bye, Miss American Pie," he says, "The three men I admire the most, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, took the last train to the coast, the day the music died." I don't know about your life and what your situation might be, but for many of us, for many of you, it feels as if things have reached their downward depth of despair. Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, must have felt the same way. Everybody was rebuking him. They wanted him to be quiet. They wanted him to not say anything. But in the midst of all of his despair, he cried out, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." And we call out to Jesus in the midst of whatever our situation may be. And we say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. Have mercy on us. Have mercy on our country." And we are finding ourselves in a situation like a midterm election. And we need to choose Jesus. Because there's no political party, whichever side is going to rescue us. The only way we're going to be rescued is by putting our faith and trust in Jesus. I don't know if you've ever heard of Antoinette Bosco, but she has really told Bartimaeus' story. She's told our story as well. She writes in her book, "The Pummeled Heart." And you hear the sound of that, "The Pummeled Heart," that she had had a difficult life. She had been in an arranged marriage that had failed. She had seven children. One was blind almost from birth because of a burst blood vessel behind his retina. She had two grandchildren, ages 2 and 4, that were in a terrible car accident. She had another son who died from a tragedy. And then she had another child that died because they had had 3 heart attacks before the age of 30. A son and his wife who were robbed and murdered. I mean, all of this sounds horrible and almost too horrible to be true. But it is true. You can read her story, Antoinette Bosco. She was very depressed. She was like many of us. She got under her covers and she would not get out of bed. But she had a friend who said, "Get up." And she said to her friend, "I can't get up." And the friend then replied, "If you think you can't, you're right." And she got so mad about that that she got up. And she chose to live. She chose to live. And this is what she writes. When the reaction to the blows of life, remember the title of the book is The Pummeled Heart. The Pummeled Heart. When you react to the blows of life and it results in a serious depression, anger, defeat, fear, even a kind of comfort in feeling sorry for yourself, you will stay in a lifeless hell unless you force yourself to get up and go on with life. Unless you force yourself to get up and go on with life. And I sit here, stand here, thinking about Bartimaeus, who's been sitting beside the road, begging, wondering, is there ever going to be any hope for me? And so he yells out, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And they rebuke him, but he shouts even louder, "Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me." And Jesus says, "Call him." And Jesus says to you, and Jesus says to me, "Call him, call her." And then we come, we throw aside our cloak and we run to Jesus. And Jesus then wants to know, "What can I do for you? What can I do for you?" And Bartimaeus says, "I want to see, I want to see." Well, we've got people among us who want Jesus to do things for them, and we're on their side. We've got plenty of people in this congregation who've been through things. Zenith Sharp, and standing before us to give us her stewardship reflection, didn't tell you the whole story about how tough this year has been because of Bob's death. And she, with a widow's mite and more, she has supported this church because we have supported her through thick and through thin. And many of you know through this past week, and I say this with her permission, that Midge Rothrock, a valued member of our staff and of our community, and especially of St. John's Church, and if you know Midge, there's never just a smidge with Midge. She gives more than that. But she found out last Monday, a week ago tomorrow, that she has adenosarcoma, a kind of cancer. She goes for a PET scan this coming Tuesday, and we want to be in prayer for her. We want to be in prayer for her. But she said that her older brother said to her, "You only need three things, and that's a good doctor, a good attitude, and a good faith." A good doctor, a good attitude, and a good faith. And so she believes. She believes. And we've got other people in our church, in our community, that we believe for them, and we want to support them. And we believe, like Bartimaeus, that there's hope. We believe, like Bartimaeus, that Jesus can do things that nobody else can do. And so we come to Jesus, and we throw off our cloaks. Can you imagine Bartimaeus? Probably the only thing that he owns is that cloak. And when Jesus said, "Call him," he throws his cloak aside, his security blanket of sorts, and he goes to Jesus, and Jesus heals him. I don't know if you remember the days of long revival services. I used to love doing revivals because I could say things at a revival service that I didn't have to clean up. That was left to the preacher who I was preaching for, and it was a lot of fun. But I remember the days of long revival services that sometimes would last for a week, sometimes would last for several weeks. But back even before that, there were long revival services. As I think about Billy Graham, for instance, in his revival, his crusade that took place in 1949 and in Los Angeles, and how rich and poor, black and white, came together. People who normally wouldn't even speak to one another, but they came together. Matter of fact, I heard about one rich man who was talking to a poor man. And the rich man said to the poor man, "For 3 months I have suffered an awful turmoil before God spoke to my soul and gave me peace." And the poor man said, "I know what you mean. I went through the same turmoil for nearly 2 weeks myself." And the rich man was upset, he asked the poor man, "Why do you think that God spoke to you so much sooner than he spoke to me? 3 months, 2 weeks." And the poor man replied, "You rich people have so much clothing on you. When Christ calls, you can't run to him as fast as a poor person can. We barely have one cloak to our name. When we hear Jesus calling, we cast it off and get up and go." I don't know what it is that you need to cast off. I've got things I need to cast off so that I can get to Jesus and find the healing that I need. But here's the real story. What do we need Jesus to do for us? What do you need Jesus to do for somebody in your family? What do you want Jesus to do for our country? It's so polarized and filled with partisanship. We need to have an election, don't we? And we need to choose Jesus over anything and anybody else. In the 1980 presidential campaign between Jimmy Carter and Ronald Reagan, there was a guy who was backpacking out west, and he was low on food and low on money. He had a plan to go into town so that he can get food. And so what he would do is he would go and talk to people on the outskirts of the town to find out whether it was Carter country or Reagan country, who people were voting for. And he would go into the local cafe, and he would say bad things and insult whoever the candidate was that people were against. And so he went into this cafe, and he said, "That Jimmy Carter, he's just an amateur idiot from Georgia. I wouldn't vote for him," and he would spiel off. Well, he thought that was exactly the right answer, and they threw him out. And so then he got back on his feet. He went back inside. He said, "Who in the world would vote for Ronald Reagan, an amateur actor from Hollywood?" And at that, a big guy throws him out. He thinks to himself, third time's a charm. He goes back inside and he asks everybody, "What country, who do y'all support? Is this Carter country or is this Reagan country?" And an old cowboy said, "Son, this ain't Carter country and this ain't Reagan country. It's horse country. Who are you going to vote for?" I pray it's Jesus' country in your heart and in my heart, in our community, our country, and world. Amen. Our hymn is, "Open my eyes that I may see." It happened to Bartimaeus. It can happen to you, and it can happen to me. It's number 454. May we stand and sing.
Oh,
may the God of all grace, who brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ and gives strength to our mortal bodies also, give you strength. May you sense God calling you through Jesus. Tell him what you need, and he will provide. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.